On the 14th of July, 2006, Britishers Ian Maitland and Henry Brownrigg were taking a trip on the Viceroy Special, the ancient steam engine named Maitland. Accompanied by a glittering entourage, the men had set off from the Fort Railway Station of the tiny island of Sri Lanka en route to Mount Lavinia, outside the capital, Colombo. The Englishmen were holidaying in the beautiful island. Nonetheless, they were there for another reason. The celebrations were grand, colorful, stately, and ceremonious, fit for a king. But who are Ian Maitland and Henry Brownrigg? What was the purpose of their visit? Why were they in Mount Lavinia? Ceylon is an island richly endowed both in physical beauty and natural wealth. It's situated conveniently at the crossroads of the major sea routes of the Orient. It was to become the main focus of attention of Western colonizers. The first to arrive on the island were the Portuguese, the Dutch, and then the British, each leaving behind legacies marking their presence on the island.
Sir Thomas Maitland arrived on the island of Ceylon and first moved into King's House in the fort of Colombo. He was very dissatisfied with the accommodation given to him because it was in a bad state of repair and the roof was leaking. And Sir Thomas Maitland wrote to the Colonial Office in London in 1805, insisting that he's given appropriate accommodation and requesting that he needs a house in the country. Sir Thomas Maitland was an extraordinary man. He spent 6 months touring around the island, and there, it seems, he came across a wonderful spot to build a house on the promontory in Gulkissa, a fishing village. 5 months later, it was here that he built his house, and he named it Mount Lavinia. Maitland was a hard-working British governor who enjoyed the company of others, and it was here at his new residence at Mount Lavinia that he gave great entertainment. And in fact, it was here that he first set eyes on Lavina Aponsua, a Matizo dancer who was half Portuguese and half Sinhalese, and he was captivated by her beauty. And from there, a romance developed which flourished in secret. And the romance was kept secret by a secret tunnel that led from the location of where Lavina lived to the cellars of the governor's residence. Their romance continued in secret for 6 years. And Lavina, or rather Lady Lavinia, is remembered as being the inspiration for the name of the house, Mount Lavinia. The next British governor to reside at Mount Lavinia was Sir Robert Brownrigg, who arrived with his wife, Lady Sophia. Lavinia Brownrigg. Sir Robert Brownrigg, in fact, produced the first descriptive reference of Mount Lavinia in a minute that he sent in 1813. This was, in fact, an important document because it showed that the house that Sir Thomas Maitland had built was not, in fact, a modest abode, but quite a grand abode of reasonable size. Mount Lavinia was to play a significant role in the governorship of Sir Robert Brownrigg over a sequence of events known as the Candian Intrigue. It was within the portals of this house that Sir Robert Brownrigg and the other major players conferred with each other. John Doyley, the Ceylon civil servant, and Elipolla Adiga, the chief minister of the Candian Kingdom. The British only controlled the coastal area of Ceylon. The upcountry Candian region was out of reach. However, Sir Robert Brownrigg had a feverish desire to take control and conquer Kandy. He promptly called an interview at his country residence, Mount Lavinia, with the Adiga, Elipolla. Fear and suspicion drove the king, Sri Vikrama Rajasinghe, to take extreme measures. And after an attempted rebellion, he executed the family of Elipolla in a shocking and cruel manner. It was to the gates of Mount Lavinia that Elipolla the Adiga ran to and was comforted by Sir Robert Brownrigg and his wife, Lady Sophia Brownrigg. Sir Robert Brownrigg not only formed a close attachment to his country residence, Mount Lavinia, but he formed an attachment to the surrounding area, wanting to develop the local area. In fact, he was the one who built the church in Galkissa, the church which is now Christ Church. And he built this on a former Dutch church using about 20 stone columns. Sir Robert Brownrigg and Lady Sophia Brownrigg left the island of Ceylon in 1820, having formed a close attachment to the house at Mount Lavinia. Sir Edward Barnes became the new British governor, and he was Lieutenant General, who arrived on the island during the same period. Sir Edward Barnes was to serve 2 years as British governor in Ceylon before he was given the coveted position as Commander of Chief in India. However, before he left the island, he wrote to the Colonial Office in London, in Downing Street, stating that he was not happy with the current state of repairs at Mount Lavinia, that it was in an urgent need of repair. Sir Edward Paget replaced Sir Edward Barnes, and he continued Sir Edward Barnes's request to the Colonial Secretary, asking for more money for the repairs at Mount Lavinia. Sir Edward Paget was to serve 9 months in the island of Ceylon, and he was the shortest serving British governor of the island. After 19 years of extreme climatic conditions, only the foundations of Maitland's house had survived. Sir Edward Barnes returned to the island of Ceylon to serve his second term of office, and he returned to Mount Lavinia with a new wife in hand. It was here that he wrote to the Colonial Secretary in London, demanding the sum of £5,000 for the repair of Mount Lavinia. But he just didn't repair the house, he actually rebuilt it on a grand classical scale, modelling the house on the banqueting house in London, an English palace. Mm-hmm. Sir Edward Barnes was asked to keep the cost as economical as possible, and he used Mount Lavinia as a training school where he used young apprentice boys to actually complete the work. The actual cost of the house, the completion of the house, in terms of labour charges, came to around £5,400. Sir Edward Barnes furnished the house exquisitely, using the best possible materials and beautiful furniture. In fact, this is the original Burma teak staircase that connected the house on two stories. And this is something that still survives today. Mount Lavinia, indeed, was a grand and magnificent residence. In the late 1850s, Mount Lavinia became a boarding house for the many planters who were located on the island. In 1877, it naturally progressed into a hotel with the first single line railway track running to its doors. When the steamships came sailing into Colombo Harbour, this brought many passengers by train, and they travelled to the shores of Mount Lavinia. Artists and writers were drawn to Mount Lavinia. This included Leonard Woolfe, the Ceylon civil servant, who was also a well-known writer, and the writer of The Village in the Jungle. In 1930, Amy Johnson arrived at Mount Lavinia for a reception given by Arthur Edward Ephraims, the private owner of the hotel at the time. Amy Johnson had flown solo from England to Australia and was thrilled to be greeted so warmly by the citizens of Ceylon in the 1930s. In 1948, various events happened, and there was the important event of the signing of independence.
On February the 4th, 1948, the people of Sri Lanka celebrated independence.
In 1956, David Lean came to the country, the legendary film director, and he produced the film The Bridge on the River Kwai. And Mount Lavinia was the perfect location for the filming of this film. Mount Lavinia Hotel, the former British governor's country residence, now celebrates its 200th anniversary. An important year for the hotel, celebrating its bicentenary year. The hotel has gone through various changes, architecturally speaking. In the 1930s, there were new additions, in the 1950s and the 1970s. And all in all, it remains a most splendid building of true historical value. I think a building that we should all be proud of. And that is Mount Lavinia Hotel.
This is a very special year for all of us at Mount Lavinia Hotel. 2006 is our bicentenary year, celebrating a momentous stage in our rich and vibrant history, a landmark occasion for the hotel. Mount Lavinia Hotel is associated with romance from its very existence. And people think it's a lucky and fortunate place for weddings. Its location, this beautiful terrace, the undisturbed beach around it, are unique features which fascinate the tourists and the locals alike. As chairman of this great establishment, I'm privileged to play a part in this chapter of its remarkable history. And all of us at Mount Lavinia Hotel will ensure that these beautiful buildings will be preserved for generations to enjoy. And also for them to experience the romance and charm that quintessentially is Mount Lavinia.
Hotel Mount Lavinia is one of the oldest and most important surviving colonial buildings in Sri Lanka. It bears testimony to the legacy left by the British. Built by the second British governor, Sir Thomas Maitland, it overlooks the sea in the village of Galkisa. The course of Sri Lanka's history was shaped within the portals of this house, where Sir Thomas Maitland's successor, Governor Sir Robert Brownrigg, John Dioye, the Ceylon civil servant, and Halipula, the Adhikar, hatched their grand master plan for the fall of Kandy into British hands. This important building is also where history and legend meet hand in hand, for it was at his stately residence that Sir Thomas first set eyes on a beautiful dancer, Lavina Aponsua, the half Portuguese, half Sinhalese lead dancer at his welcoming party. Sir Thomas, who was smitten by her smile, and who soon found himself obsessed by her charms, could not marry Lavina and died a bachelor away from Ceylon. But he named his palace Mount Lavinia House. Today, the monument to his only love has been preserved within the walls and high ceilings of the Mount Lavinia Hotel. The gentle waves have wiped away the lover's footprints. The wind has blown away their passionate exhale. But time stands still in Mount Lavinia, whispering legends of adventure and love.